and forever. Moments gone, time runs out, and then it hits you with pain. Things are great on the way out, but nobody's with you when you're on the way down. You got what you wish for. Is that what you're
Tell us about your athletic background and how your affinity for the sport of volleyball came around, Larry.
Well, I grew up in Santa Monica, and the junior high school that I played at was a small school in Santa Monica called John Adams Junior High School. And the coaches there were two coaches that I learned to love and revere over the years, but they were great mentors to me as a youngster going into junior high school. Their name was Don Steere and Dave Heiser. They were both just wonderful people, great coaches, and they both happened to be avid beach volleyball players from Sereno Beach and State Beach. And some of the other coaches there also played in beach doubles. Don McMahon was one of them, and they all play. And so I grew up, every time I would go to the gym, there was a volleyball net up, and it was just natural that we played. And so I grew up playing there, and I remember every summer while I was young, I would go to John Adams Junior High School from 9 o'clock till 5 o'clock all day, and there was kind of a hierarchy there. On one half of the gym, there was the 3-on-3 basketball court going, and then on the other half of the gym was a net where doubles was being played. So if you could, at the top of the pecking order was the 3-on-3 basketball. If you could win there, you could kept on continuing to stay there. If you lost, you would usually go down to the doubles court and play volleyball, and if you lost there, you went into the hallway and played ping pong. so that's how I spent my summers every day, you know, trying to stay on the basketball court as long as I could, or volleyball or ping pong. And those two coaches were the ones that really got me started, and I got where there was, you know, playing so much volleyball, just indoor doubles, that I just grew up playing it. And one of the things that was kind of coincidental about my career is that I was so small, you know, when I was young. I mean, I tell people that when I got my driver's license at age 16, it said on my driver's license, 5'2", 95 pounds.
Wow.
That was at age 16, so you can see how small I was. And so I learned to hit. I mean, Don Steere used to talk when there weren't too many people in the gym. He would just throw balls up for me at half court, and I would just try to spike them. If I could just try to get it in and just spin it into the back line, I would be thrilled. But he would spend, you know, a half an hour, sometimes an hour, with just tossing balls and having me hit. And that when I finally got so that I could actually spike a ball, it was really thrilling to me. But the other thing about that was I was so small that I really couldn't set the ball overhand. It was very difficult for me to do it. So I just started bumping everything. And I got so that I was very proficient at bumping. And then when I get to UCLA in 1965, they changed the rules. So everybody had to bump the serve. You couldn't take serve overhand. I said, hey, this is cool. I'm the best bumper on the team. So that was pretty event for me. So, but those coaches there at at John Adams and Santa Monica and playing. Those were the guys I played with. And then I also, during the summers also, as I got a little older, I used to go to Lincoln Junior High School and play volleyball with my good buddy Larry Milliken. He and I used to have Donnybrook matches back and forth, and Larry's just a wonderful player and a great historian. Lived up in Santa Barbara now.
He's good pals with the greatest volleyball journalist ever, John Lee, is he not?
Oh, yeah. Oh, Larry is it. Yeah, Larry and John. They're terrific. They're so much fun to talk with, and they were both very helpful. Larry was, especially when my daughter went to UCSB and set for the Gauchos up there.
Brooke Rundle, was it not?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, Kathy Gregory, when I interviewed her, I think mentioned something about her. So, pretty good lineage. She came from pretty good stock, so that's good stuff.
Well, she had a lot of people ask me, you know, make sure you don't push Brooke into volleyball, and I said, push her. She's pulling me. I'm not pushing her.
Let's go, Dad.
You know, I come home, she goes, Daddy, can we go set? Because when she grew up, we lived in Westlake Village, and we had a big backyard, and I put in a sand volleyball court back there. And, you know, since I got home, she wanted to go out and practice setting, and so we set by the hour. By the time she got to college, she was a damn good setter.
Yeah. Wow, that's an awesome story. Now, Don Steere, he was the high school football coach at Santa Monica High School, was he not?
That's correct.
And his wife, Patty Steere, was a heck of a player and made, they made that Steere sportswear that all those guys were wearing for a while in the 70s, I believe.
Don was my coach, and his wife was Patty Steere, who was a very, very good player, a very good beach player in herself, and Don was the coach, and then he moved on to Santa Monica High School, where he became the high school coach.
Wow.
And one thing that's funny about Dave Heiser, who is just a wonderful guy. I don't know if you've had that name, but he was a great coach. But we became friends instantly, and as I grew older, and our relationship changed from me being a student and him being the coach to us being more friends. It was a very funny story, because in 1956, when I went to John Adams Junior High School, they used to have like a little mini decathlon, and they would put the records for the decathlon up on the board in the office, and having your name by one of the school records was a really, really big honor, because, you know, there was your name printed right up there, you know, and the events were like how many baskets could you make in a minute, how many chin-ups could you do, how many pull-ups, how many this and that, and one of them was how many consecutive free throws you could make. So in 1956, when I was just my second year of junior high school, the school record was 11 consecutive, and that had been held for something like 10 years. So I entered that event, and I make 6, and then I make 7 in a row, 8, 9, 10, and on my 11th, I choked and just dropped an air ball, because I just, you know, it was just so tense making that one. And the coach just grabbed the ball right out of the air and said, don't worry, just toss it to me. And he threw it back to me to have started shooting again for my second attempt.
Right.
So the second attempt, I go, 8, 9, 10. And I hit the 11th to tie it up. I hit the 12th one to tie it up and made 5 more. And I made 17 consecutive free throws to set the record, which stayed until 1998. from 1956 to 1998. That was the school record of consecutive free throws. And so now in 1998, I get a registered letter in the mail, and I open it up, and it's from Dave Heiser, who was my coach there, and it said, Dear Mr. Rundle, we regret to inform you that your that your school record has been broken. And then he went on to talk something, but I just remember opening that first line saying, we regret to inform you.
Yeah, right.
Those were good. They were great guys. Anyway, I'm going on. But those were the guys that I started. And then as I started playing more volleyball, and as I got into high school, I just played indoors. We didn't have a high school team then, and there was no indoor games that I knew about, other than the doubles indoors that I used to play.
And Ron Hagen tells the story of practicing indoors at that John Adams middle school. He'd do that for six-man, you know, during the fall and the winter or spring, and he always has such an eye for talent. Like, he recognized Buzz Swartz when he was a young guy coming up, and he said he saw this smallish, skinny kid playing doubles on one of the other courts and, like, recognized, like, that kid could be really good. And when he'd ask who you were, to some of the other established indoor players that were playing there, they're like, he's too little, or he's got skills, but he's too little, or what have you. And Von Hagen's like, you just wait and watch. And sure enough, he was right. Do you remember seeing those volleyball gods over there when you were a young kid?
I absolutely remember. Absolutely remember Ronnie, because Ronnie was, when I was at that period of time, Ronnie was a very well-established player. I mean, I had started to know about the players, and I knew about Ronnie. And I would go over there and play in my usual whatever games I could get in. And I played with a dear friend of mine named Ronnie Snyder, who would play doubles with me, and I would play against those guys. And the thing that I could do. So much than all of the rest of them was that I could pass, you know, underhand pass, because that's what I grew up doing. Because I couldn't set overhand. The ball was too big and it was too heavy for my hands, and so I could really pass well. And remember, that was right when they were transitioning during that '64 period, right at the '64 Olympics. You know, when they first found out that they couldn't receive the serve overhand, you had to bump it. All the game that they had all played up to that time was you pass everything overhand. So I was right at that transition where I had developed a skill which then became the required passing skill. But I used to play doubles, and Ronnie, I remember playing against Ronnie and being odd that I was getting to play on the same court with Ronnie Von Hagen. That was really exciting for me at that time.
I can imagine. Now, when you were going down to the beach, who were the established players that you were in awe of and really looked up to when you were coming up through the ranks, Larry?
Well, I didn't play a whole lot of beach volleyball. My game was indoors. I mean, my whole focus, mostly of my career, was indoors. But as I finally got to the beach, and probably my senior year in college, I mean, there was two guys, and you've heard their names, and they played at Sorrento Beach.
Von Hagen and Darth Vader.
I mean, there was so many other players, but I mean, there was two guys. I mean, now I didn't, at 63 and 64, I didn't get to see Mike Bright or O'Hara or Selznick, and I didn't get to see those guys when they were competing at that. I didn't really start until 68. That was my first season. I mean, my first really semi-volleyball was when I think I got my, first I got my single A with, by winning a single A tournament at Muscle Beach with a guy named Jeff Rohr, and then the following week I played in the Sereno Beach doubles tournament with Greg Miller, who was my UCLA teammate, indoors, and we won the doubles at, in the double A tournament, so then I became triple A. All of a sudden I went from nothing to triple A in 2 weeks. But the guys that were the most dominant were certainly Von Hagen and Lang, Mike Bright, you know, who I think the world, but Mike Bright was a fabulous, fabulous athlete, great person and great role model. I really idolized Mike. And, the Carter brothers and even J.B. Bordwell and Von Hagen and Lang, of course, and Keith and Ernie Suwara, those were the guys.
Now, when you were at UCLA, there's that great photo of you, and then you can see Ernie passing. Tell us about your time at UCLA. You got to play with both Ernie Suwara and Keith Erickson. Gosh, I mean, those two guys alone right now there, I heard, just could put craters in the floor. You tell us about that time playing with them?
The first, in 65, my first year indoors, was with Ernie. First time I met Ernie, I had not really met him, but I had played against him in an indoor doubles at Santa Monica City College, and he was playing with Butch May, and I was stunned. I was in awe. I had never seen anybody hit the ball as hard as Ernie could hit it. I had seen people hit it from, maybe hit it higher, jump higher, or hit it higher, but never anybody hit the ball as explosively hard as he did. And as I got to join Ernie at UCLA, I mean, it was just amazing how good he was. I would have, the one thing I regret, I wish I could have played with Ernie against, other than college competition. I would have loved to have been on our 68 Olympic team, so I could have seen how he played against the international players.
Right.
But in terms of the college players, I mean, he was men among boys, and he hit the ball so hard. But it wasn't just his hitting; it was how far over the net he would get when he blocked. I mean, sometimes he would just, it seemed like he would just absolutely smother him. And he was an amazing player. Ernie, I think, was probably just for hitting. I think he was the hardest hitter I ever played with. Now, Keith really just joined us for the end of the season. He just joined us for our first national championship, which I believe, in talking to Al, I was asking him the other day, I said, wasn't 65 your first national championships? And I think he confirmed that it was, so I'm quite proud of that. But it wasn't an NCAA sport then. But Keith joined us at the national championships, and we're playing in a college college division of the USBBA, United States Volleyball Association National Championship. And we're playing against other colleges, including Santa Monica City College, which was the dominant force up to that time. And between Ernie and Keith, I mean, all we had to do was set them and the ball would go down. It was almost laughable how good they hit. And then I was in the background just passing everything, and I said, man, this is easy.
Putting your legendary passing skills to the test.
Yeah, all I would do was pass, and then they would put the ball away, and they had great fun putting it away.
You had a nice bird's eye view at those, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. I was thrilled to get to play with Keith because I was such a fan of the way he would their 64 national championship team when he played, you know, when he played on the John Wooden team that did won the NCAAs with the press.
Mm-hmm.
Remember the press, and Keith was the point man in the press, and we used to go to the game and I'd sit in the stands and we'd laugh because the game would be 2.5 minutes into the game and UCLA was ahead 16-2 with 5 turnovers, 3 steals by Keith, 2 blocks by Keith. You know, they were just fantastic to watch how that team worked. But Keith was just such an extraordinary, extraordinary athlete. I think Keith is the best all-around athlete I have ever known. I mean, between his basketball, his legendary basketball skill career, and then what a great volleyball player he was. And, years later, we got to play golf together, and we played with a good friend, a guy named Gene Pfluger at Wardwell, and we played with Keith. And I played with Keith on what he said was his 6-month anniversary of picking up his first golf club, and he shot 76.
Yeah. Now,
so, I mean, you know that, and John Wooden, Coach Wooden, said that Keith was the best athlete he ever coached.
Yeah, I think along with Rafer Johnson, Von Hagen's fonda reminding me of that. I think Coach Wooden said those two were the two best athletes he ever coached, and that's saying a lot considering all the thoroughbreds.
Did John Wooden coach Rafer Johnson?
Yeah, he did. Rafer was on that team, believe it or not, for maybe a year or so.
I didn't know that.
Neither did I. But yep, he was for a brief time. And the other thing I heard about Keith, didn't he go to UCLA on a tennis scholarship? And I also heard
story I've always known is that he went there on a baseball scholarship.
Yeah, that too. He was a great tennis player, but that he could have been if he went to the major leagues. He could have been an all-star shortstop. That's how good he was. I mean, that's just. He was Bo Jackson before Bo Jackson, except more sports.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. There was so many funny stories. When when Selznick first put together his Wilt's Big Dippers, you remember that?
Oh, I sure do.
Yeah, but when he put together the first Wilt's Big Dippers, so I got to meet Wilt for the first time, and I was in awe the first time like everybody is, and then after a few practices, we started to kind of get friendly. I was able to do a little trash talking about, you know, as an athlete. I started to rag him a little bit about his free throw shooting and stuff. And then Keith was there. We were all kind of kidding around it. And so Wilt says to me, "So Larry, you know, you're halfway decent basketball player, right?" I said, "Yeah." You know, and he said, "Well, why don't you play one-on-one with Keith? I played 10. Each basket counts one. I bet you won't get a shot off." And so I look at Will. I said, "Well, what do you mean I won't get a shot off?" He said, "You won't get a shot off." I said, "You mean I won't even make a shot?" "No, you won't get a shot off." I said, "Oh, okay. I'll take that bet." So I start, and Keith gets in front of me, and I start doing all these head fakes, and I fake to the right, and I fake to the left, and Keith is just standing there, stone-faced, and then I do a fake like I'm going to drive and just try to do a stunt, and Keith looks at me and goes, "What are you doing?" holy cow. So then I tried to drive left, and he lets me drive right by him, and as soon as I go up to the layup, a hand goes right over my head, slaps the ball away. Then I try a hook shot, slaps the ball away. Then I try a 25-foot fadeaway, slaps the ball away. I said, okay.
You lost that bet, Larry.
that's right. But that was great fun. And it was great fun playing on those early Big Dippers. One funny story, the very inaugural match of the Wilt Big Dippers. It was played in Santa Cruz. And have I ever told you this story?
I don't think so. About this? Fire away.
Okay, so Selznick, unbeknownst to the rest of the guys, had this flyer printed up, and he sent it out to all these club teams across the country, advertising Wilt's Big Dippers, our four against your six, and here's the terms, and he put Gene Selznick, team manager, with a phone number underneath it, and without telling me or Keith or anybody, and the phone number on the letter at the bottom, as under Gene Selznick, team manager, the phone number was the State Beach parking lot telephone.
I heard that phone booth was pretty famous there. A guy
knows it. It was the State Beach public telephone number, and so because anytime that phone book rang, it was for Selznick. So anybody, all these guys, it was if the phone ever rang, no matter who it was, if somebody would pick up and say hello, and they'd tell me there, and if it's Selznick, it's for you.
That's classic. That was Gene's personal cell phone or operator.
Yeah, right? That's right. And so the first team that hooked us up is a club team up in Santa Cruz, California. So Selznick negotiates that they had to send us down a deposit for our plane fare, our plane tickets, and a deposit in advance against the salaries that we would be requiring. And Selznick used the money that he got to go out and have some uniforms made for us with the number we're writing, Wilt's Big Dippers. So at any rate, we fly up to Santa Cruz. We arrive at the airport, and there's a guy from the newspaper. And he said, I'd like to interview you guys, and I'll take you to dinner. And we said, oh, great. So we get in his car, we go out to dinner, and we sit down at this little dinner in a restaurant, and the reporter said, so, Mr. Selznick, it's a real honor to have you. We'll speak Dippers team here. It's got a sold-out house. So I'd like to get started here. So what's your record? Keith and I look at each other, and Selznick says, we're undefeated. And so, Keith and I said, well, that's true.
All in all.
No, no. No, and the guy says a little bit later, he goes, I know you're undefeated. A little bit later in the interview, he goes, one more thing. A little bit, I know you're undefeated, but what is your actual record? And so Selznick says, 17-0. And oh my God. So then he looked, and I look over Keith, I said, Keith, can we get in trouble for this?
Not with Selznick.
And so we opened up the newspaper that morning, and in the little Santa Cruz newspaper, it says, Wilt Big Dippers put 17-game win streak on the line. So it turned out that we sold the house, and we had a great show, and the club that sponsored it made their entire year's money to support their whole team, and it was a tremendous success, and we went on from there.
And you guys,
that was so typical.
18-0.
Yeah.
Now, at that dinner, I heard Selznick's enjoyed a nice meal always. Did he have, like, soup and like, pie or dessert and all that other fun stuff?
I don't remember, but Selznick was great. It was so much fun. It was always so much fun playing with him. And Wilt and Selznick became great friends. And one of the funny stories that was playing with Wilt that I always got a kick out of telling was, after about, we had played in first Santa Cruz, and it was a big success. And then out of the blue, it finds out that it got around, and pretty soon some other teams were trying to call us, and we were starting to get some bookings. After about probably the third or fourth match, I got to backtrack. When we played, we always told the opponent that don't, whatever you do, because Wilt's just learning the game. He can play at the net, but he doesn't pass, or he doesn't, you know, he doesn't dig or anything. So don't serve it at him. Serve it over there, but serve it, you know, Larry takes most of the serve. So just serve down the, somewhere down the middle, or serve a Ketih, but don't serve it Wilt. Don't try to make him look bad. So after about the third or fourth one of our matches with playing, they serve one right down the line at Wilt. And I step in right in front of Wilt and pass it over to Selz, and we put it away. And Wilt says to me, "Larry, that was my ball." And so I said, "Wilt, you know I do the passing." He said, "No, I'm going to do my own passing from now on." And so I look over at Selz and I say, "Selz, Wilt wants to do his own passing now." And this, the game is going on, and this is all going on during the game. And Selz looks at Wilt. "Willie, Rundle does the passing." Wilt says, "No, I'm going to do my own passing." So we call timeout. We walk over the timeout, and Selz looks up at Wilt and says, "Okay, you want to do your own passing, right?" "Okay." Time in. Go back. The very next serve was right down the line to Wilt. He shanks it. It goes straight out of bounds, straight into the stands. And I look at him, and he looks at me, and Wilt says, "That was your ball."
Just like him. Just like his card playing and everything, right?
Just so funny.
Thank you.
Thank you.